Einen schönen guten Abend und herzlich willkommen hier im Kino des Deutschen Filmmuseums zu unserer Reihe Lecture and Film. Heute geht es natürlich wie immer um Agnès Varda, aber diesmal um den Anfang ihrer Karriere, den allerersten Film, den sie gedreht hat, La Pointe Courte. Und sie hat ihn tatsächlich auch vor kurzer Zeit restauriert. Das heißt, wir werden heute eine ja doch ziemlich tolle Fassung, Kopie, DCP, wie man es ja digital jetzt heißt, von diesem Film erleben dürfen mit englischen Untertiteln aus deren eigenen Produktionsfirma Cine Tamaris, die uns den Film zukommen haben lassen. Dafür auch schon mal herzlichen Dank an dieser Stelle muss das auch mal erwähnt werden, dass da so eine tolle Kooperation besteht, ebenso wie mit all unseren Partnern von der Goethe-Universität im Exzellenzcluster, die den freien Eintritt ermöglicht, bis hin zu der Hessischen Film- und Medienakademie und dem Institut Français. Wir haben so viele tolle Unterstützer. Dafür nochmal einen herzlichen Applaus an dieser Stelle. Das kann man mal machen. Wie immer gibt es auch ein Begleitprogramm in diesem Monat und das ist auch wieder ganz spannend, denn die anderen beiden Lectures in diesem Monat widmen sich Varda und Los Angeles. Und so wird zum Beispiel am Samstag ein Film laufen, den ich Ihnen sehr ans Herz legen möchte. Los Angeles Plays Itself von Tom Anderson. Das ist ein Film, in dem er aus Szenen, die in dieser Stadt spielen, die zusammenmontiert und daraus eine Charakterisierung von Los Angeles macht. Das ist wirklich sehenswert und sieht man auch recht selten, auch ganz frisch als DCP erschienen. Dann zeigen wir Model Shop, das Fotomodell von Jacques Demy zu der Zeit, als Varda eben auch in L.A. war. Er war ihr Ehemann und dementsprechend hat er in der Zeit dort diesen Spielfilm realisiert. Und als drittes noch Killer of Sheep, Schafe töten von Charles Burnett. Ein ganz wunderbarer Blaxploitation-Film, den ich Ihnen sehr ans Herz legen möchte. Auch den gibt es in diesem Monat auf 35mm dann zu sehen. Das nur als kleine Vorausschau und heute freue ich mich wirklich über einen ganz wunderbaren Gast, Richard Neupert, und Vincent Zediger wird ihn vorstellen. Viel Vergnügen.
So. Ja, guten Abend auch von meiner Seite. Richard hätte es beinahe nicht geschafft, weil sein TGV auf der Höhe von Nancy eine Hirschherde durchfuhr. Und deswegen hat die Fahrt dann statt 4 Stunden 11 gedauert oder so, aber hat es gerade noch knapp geschafft und ist jetzt hier und kann heute Abend zu uns sprechen und jetzt wirklich auf Englisch. Agnès Varda famously claims that she had only ever seen 3 films in her entire life when she made her own first feature film, La Pointe Courte, in 1954. If she had seen more, she probably would not have embarked on the project and on a career as a film director, she also likes to say. As you will see shortly, one is tempted not to trust this claim of ingenuity and artistic naivete in the face of the remarkable artistic achievement that the film constitutes. While the film failed to reach a wide audience at first, she hadn't really thought about distribution, but that's a different story. It was certainly a visionary work in many ways. Edited by Alain René, it harked back to both Italian neorealism and anticipated the stylish modernism of René's own feature films, a tension that Richard will be talking about, I think. Some even call it the first film of the Nouvelle Vague, produced for 4 years before the Nouvelle Vague began. Now, I've just sort of sowed a little doubt about Varda's own self-historicization. And as Richard said on our way here, one of the remarkable things about Agnès Varda is that she is her own best historian because she's constantly historicizing her own work in public statements and also changes the story sometimes. Now, few people would be better placed to disentangle that web of evolving narratives about Agnès Varda than one of the leading film historians of not just Agnès Varda, but the French cinema of the post-war period in general, than our guest tonight, Professor Richard Neupert. Richard earned his PhD at the University of Wisconsin in Madison, one of the birthplaces of film studies in the United States, and he perfected his education in Paris, where he worked, among others, with one of the founding figures of film theory, Christian Metz. He has been a professor of film studies at the University of Georgia for many years, where he is currently the Wheatley Professor of the Arts and the Josiah Meeks Distinguished Teaching Professor, as well as the coordinator of the film studies program. And on the side, he runs an art house cinema, which has been going for 6 years now. Nine, sorry. Yeah, 9 years, and is actually going strong. Richard Neupert's areas of expertise in film studies cover a wide variety of fields, from narratology to film history to animation aesthetics and practice. He is most notably the author of four monographs, four books, including The End, Narration and Closure in Cinema from 1995, A History of the French New Wave, which was first published in 2003 and published again in an expanded second edition in 2007, which indicates clearly that it is the standard text in the English language on the subject. Furthermore, there is a book called French Animation History, published in 2011, and most recently, John Lasseter, the first book-length study on the main creative talent behind the success of the Pixar animation films, a book which was published earlier this year. Apart from his impressive achievements in a variety of areas of film studies, film history, film theory, Richard Neupert is also a pioneer in interdisciplinary empirical research on film, as he currently conducts a research project on the impact of film trailers on audiences, a project that he pursues together with the neuroscience department at the University of Georgia, and on a topic that is particularly dear to me, as some people here will know, because I once wrote a book on trailers. Now, please welcome together with me our distinguished guest, Richard Neupert.
Thank you, Vincent, and thank you to Urs and everyone involved with this marvelous year-long series. It's a terrific idea, and I am embarrassed. My name is Neupert, and my father's parents were both born in Germany, but came to the States as young children, and they died young. And I never heard them speak German, so I don't know any German other than Bit ein bit is about it. But anyway, I'm really thrilled to be here in Frankfurt. And yeah, the 10-hour train trip today was not expected, so I was hoping to see more of the city by now. But it's been a long day. So this is much more fun to talk about Agnes Varda and the movies. Now, when Agnes Varda's first film, La Pointe Courte, premiered in 1955, it proved that a new sort of youthful cinema was possible, if not yet bursting on the scene, as we'll discuss. This unusual project challenged the conventions of its era on every level. It was made by a young woman with no motion picture background, as Vincent's mentioned, or professional experience. And the professional part's real important, I think. The story juxtaposes the daily gestures and reality of the inhabitants of La Pointe Courte, and we'll come back to it in a second, a southern French fishing village, if you don't know where it is, with the highly stylized performances. She's going to contrast the village with the highly stylized performances of a young Parisian couple visiting La Pointe Courte, which acts as both a sort of realistic and theatrical setting for their leisurely discussions about life and love. Moreover, Varda's training in art and photography motivated a highly unusual visual style, while the risky editing strategies built a stunning, almost abstract time and space. So this unprecedented mode of production and highly personal story and style set the foundations for the rest of Varda's career, but also provided a creative blueprint for the new and restless generation that would become known as La Nouvelle Vague, the French New Wave. Now, this evening, I want to reinsert this movie into its context and offer some thoughts on how its structure and storytelling challenge the norms of how we typically watch and understand cinematic characters a little bit. So, if La Pointe Courte looks rather eccentric to us today, just think what it must have looked like in the mid-1950s, before Breathless and Abu Dhusuf and Hiroshima Mon Amour. It's worth noting that one of the first reviews of La Pointe Courte by Annette Reynaud in Cahiers du Cinéma observed this quote here, that it's almost impossible to place this film in the context of film history. I mean, that's what Cahiers wanted to do, show where everything came from. They couldn't do it with this movie. It emerges from a nothingness, a jumbled mix of photography, modern philosophy, Faulkner novels, poetry. All and none of these things contribute to the meaning of this work. So it leads that ambiguity too. Does it mean anything? If so, where does it come from? Unquote. This review acknowledges the unconventional vitality displayed by La Pointe Courte, which refuses to respect the viewer's expectations, to fall in line with any art cinema norms of the period. On every level, Agnes Varda defies the cinematic norms of the 1950s, and in doing so, she helps launch a new sort of auteurist film practice that reinvigorated film criticism and production options for decades to come, I think. So Agnes Varda, she began her creative career, and some of this you might know very well. I just want to make sure everybody in the room is kind of familiar with the background, because it's really pertinent for this movie more than anything I think you've seen this year. That she began her creative career as a still photographer, but only after pursuing some courses in art history at the Sorbonne, where she quickly became frustrated. Though, as Bernard Bastide, who's written about her extensively, says, you know, she did learn to love some ideas like Gaston Bachelard in particular, she mentions over and over still. But in a more practical turn, Varda enrolled at what was then the Vaugirard School of Photography. They had a cinema division. She did the photography division. She also attended part-time courses for art curators at the Louvre over a period of several years, on and off, where she learned more about art history, but especially, as she likes to say, I learned to look. I learned to see things anew. For instance, she often mentions how valuable Edgar Degas paintings are, and among the Impressionists, for would-be filmmakers, since Degas often captures his figures in movement, but just also poses them as they're coming into or exiting the frame. Watch during tonight's movie where you kind of sit there and wonder, is something going to come into this frame? Or other times seems like, well, why would you start the shot there while somebody's just walking out of it? So this fascination with painting she's going to use as an inspiration. She also read widely in literature during this intense learning period. Now, fortunately for everybody, Varda's first big career break came thanks to her childhood friend, André Schlegel, and her Schlegel's husband, Jean Villard, both natives of Sète. I just want to make sure, oh, this has got a little, anyway, Sète's right here, if you don't know, on the Mediterranean. La Pointe Courte is going to be this section right in here on the back side, so not on the Mediterranean, but by the Etang pond here. Anyway, that Villard and Schlegel had come from there. This is the city adjacent to La Pointe Courte. Varda spent World War II, as you may know, in Sète as a teenager and formed important, lasting friendships with many people there. Jean Villard soon became a rising force in live theater, and Varda became the official photographer for Villard's theatrical company. For their brand new Avignon Theater Festival that is still ongoing today, that was formed in 1948, Varda was hired to record and document rehearsals, the sets, and actors in costume as their official archivist. She also began staging photographs beyond the immediate theatrical spaces. Now, Villard, the theatrical director's notions of mise en scène, influenced her own concepts very early on, and even her process. Here's some images. Villard, for example, staged Shakespeare plays in the vast court of honor of the Palais des Papes, the Pope's palace in Avignon, rather than in theaters necessarily. On real stages, he did away with the usual decorative sets, inserting actors into nearly bare stages sometimes, acknowledging the artifice and really emphasizing the architectural space around the actors. Whenever somebody starts to act, they make the space in Villard's notion. So even when he took over the Théâtre National Populaire in Paris, the old Chaillot Palace in 1951, and then would still do Avignon, he preferred these minimally abstract, even empty stages to a more commercial theatrical look. Now, Varda quickly built on Villard's methods, mixing in some self-conscious Brechtian touches we'll discuss in a little bit. She learned from Villard as well, Brechtian touches she learned from Villard, as she staged distinctive portraits of the actors. She often placed them like statues, but in natural settings, anything to get away from those conventional, theatrical, glamour kinds of shots. That's what she was trying not to do. And she famously made Gérard Philippe, one of Villard's important young star actors, stand outside in... There it is. I hit something wrong. She made, for example, him stand outside in full costume and bright sunlight for sometimes unsettling, evocative kinds of portraits. And there in the middle is, I've got mentioned at least, Philippe Noiret, the star of tonight's film, is holding down Gérard Philippe's shoulders during a rehearsal out in the sunlight. Charles Denner is way in the background. And just as an aside, it might be worth noting that while François Truffaut in the early 50s is earning his reputation as a vicious, if insightful, critic, attacking regularly the theater of quality and especially quality actor star Gérard Philippe, Agnes Varda was really helping build his image, shape his career in lots of ways. She photographed him for 8 consecutive years working with the Villar theater troupe, and a lot of those images have now become some just incredibly iconic as well. So Varda's technical training as a photographer, and especially her practice with Villar in the theater, allowed her valuable experience in just a lot of different situations. Bernard Bastide is going to point out, and here's this great quote, she learned to capture and transmit the precise trigger moment, the effervescent moment where the direction of a glance, a movement of a hand, revealed the true psychology of a character, unquote. So beyond working with Villar's theatrical troupe, Varda sought out other paid photography assignments as well, from weddings to doing magazine ads and layouts, any kind of advertisement. Anybody who would hire her, she would do those as well. So she got great preparation here from her knowledge and experience with film stock, with lenses, exposure times of the era, but also with this fascination with the visual arts, storytelling, staging, and all that. It proved really vital for the radical look and really the subject matter of tonight's film and her independent mode of production, I want to argue. So Varda was also close friends with Villar's wife's sister, Suzanne Schlegel, and she does discuss them in the Beaches of Agnes movie. So the sister of Villar's wife, Suzanne, lived in Paris. She had married a man named Pierre Fournier, who will be important now. They also, all of them, grew up in Sète, in southern France, knew her from World War II. Anyway, she knew them well in Paris, and suddenly Pierre Fournier became very ill. He was diagnosed with brain cancer. So the three of them decided on Easter break to take a final vacation trip while he was still strong enough to go home to Sète, because they all missed it and he wanted to visit it again. And she decided to document their return to La Pointe Courte, the little fishing village in Sète. But in addition to bringing her usual Rolleiflex large format camera, she borrowed a 16 millimeter camera from a friend. As she recalls, she wanted to make a sort of home movie, preserving this event for the Fournier family and for herself. Thus, nostalgia, memory, personal engagement are all going to figure in her work right from the beginning. Now, once down there, Varda renewed her longtime fascination with this fishing village of La Pointe Courte, tucked in the edge of that pond, behind the more glamorous side of the coastal city of Sète. The actual conception of an eventual film seems to have come in fits and starts, springing from a sort of faith in the potential of moving images to record, preserve, and inspire. And in some ways, this home movie idea transformed her into sort of a Bazanian mission of the sort of mummy complex. She wanted to sort of preserve something from the past, at the same time admit it was ending as she went. It was, again, a very personal time. And this visit also prompted Varda to begin thinking about the potential of cinema to expand her technical abilities and her creative options. And it's worth noting that unlike the later cohort of New Wave directors, and especially Claude Chabrol, François Truffaut, Eric Rohmer, etc., Varda never had a drawer full of scripts. It's not like she was secretly looking for an occasion to make a movie. It's not like she had stories she wanted to tell and just looking for a producer. And further, unlike her good friend Alain René or someone like Louis Malle, she would never have considered getting into movies by adapting someone else's material. That's really not why she was proceeding. So the more spontaneous and intuitive Varda seemed to have grown rather naturally into being a potential filmmaker. As she wrote later on, the sad visit inspired her in many ways. Quote, this friendly, sad couple prefigured the talkative couple that I would imagine later on in La Pointe Courte. And she said already, oops, I'm not doing my, here we go. I should have hit the Fourniers here. Anyway, this is 16 millimeter footage that has been blown up, and I include some of the quotes from Varda's The Beaches of Agnes, Les Plages d'Agnès, to show her talking back in this whole idea that Vince mentioned of her being sort of retelling the story of how it all happened. So there's the shot from tonight's movie in the middle with the two actors, and you can barely see the little cart behind them wheeling along and the men in place. That's really almost identical to that middle shot that's very out of focus of her friends when she walked along with them in the 16 millimeter. So she kind of grew naturally into this and says, yeah, this friendly silent couple prefigures the talkative characters later on. And she said she already, while visiting, started to notice at La Pointe Courte that there are really two sides to everything. There was the light side of the peninsula and the dark side, that there was sort of men's work and women's work, that there were sort of harsh kind of metal things with hooks and things like that, and then these sort of beautiful nets and wood. So she started to already act like there was this kind of binary world she wanted to somehow capture as well. So, in fact, the space and setting of La Pointe Courte on this visit, this really sentimental visit, affected Varda deeply. After all, these three old friends were wandering past fishing families and their daily routines and challenges as if it was some kind of timeless background. She said nothing had changed in the 10 years since we'd all been there together playing as children. So moreover, the fishermen could hardly appreciate the fears and problems of this threesome of a vacationing couple and their quirky friend with a 16mm camera running past them and making movies. So they never really engaged between the people and the background during this short term, and that ultimate failure of the two groups to really understand each other is going to really form the conceptual essence of La Pointe Courte tonight. I should also note that the exact sequence of events, and this kind of goes back to the history stuff, of events and the initial inspiration are a little bit contradictory. While Agnès Varda now again claims that, well, she was already using them, as she says here, as stand-ins for the later couple, in other earlier accounts, she argued that it was only when she got back to Paris and Pierre Fournier died that she started to feel like, oh, I've got to do something with these pictures. How can I make a tribute? Oh, I've got this footage. Maybe I should make a movie. So when it actually started is a little bit contradictory in some ways. Regardless, once she did get back to Paris, she entered into a really unconventional sort of pre-production period, making a feature film she was not sure she would actually be able to produce. Further, when Pierre Fournier did die, it really kind of triggered almost a compulsion that she really had to do something with all this footage, but she really didn't know what. So it was that she was compelled into making cinema, not sat down and said, I'd like to be a filmmaker. How do I get started? So it really was a very personal decision. And of course, she ends up dedicating the film to him as well, the Pierrot at the beginning of this movie. Well, at this point, all she had were some 16mm clips that could function as location scouts and maybe test reels, plus some photos of the people and objects in La Pointe Courte. And given that she was still employed full-time by the Villar Theater Company, she worked on her script weekends. And whenever she get a spare time. And she regularly sorted through her photographs to help organize her thoughts, and a lot of the 16mm shots became like storyboards for an eventual project. Thus, rather than sort of seeking out some instructive how to make movies kind of booklet or finding some professional to tell her, she just really started organizing her material ahead of time. She followed her own methods. And that's why I do think she was really sort of an outsider. She really was a naive storyteller. And as far as I can tell, she really didn't seek out a lot of guidance early on in the process. She really just worked on her own. So during this kind of strange pre-production period, she did travel back to La Pointe Courte, chatted more with the fishermen and their families, tried to make them comfortable with her presence and idea to take a film there. Would they let her shoot their children and them fishing and things like that. And this was kind of research, almost ethnographic research, to help shape anecdotes and the events that she would put in the movie later on as well. So importantly, her mode of production balances this sort of very precise outline that she's got early on. I mean, here you've got this handwritten script where she's actually even got like in, let's see if I can move this, here it says like, you know, off, like voice off, you know. So she's already written out everything the fishermen are going to say, but then as she says in her movie, oh, you know, the fishermen and their families always missed a word or two. So, I mean, she's precisely written what that she wants them to say in lots of scenes, but then she would also use improvisation or just chance events and put those into the film as well. So there's this real mix between sort of documentary elements into a very carefully composed fiction. So back in Paris, while she's working on all this stuff and going back and forth and she really wants to make something, she does seek out some people who know something about movies. She meets this very young couple. And I think I've got one more. Yeah. At 25, I just started to write this script. She met this couple, Carlos and Jane Villadarbo, and these were amateur filmmakers also in their 20s. And they encouraged her when she talked about her idea, just move forward with your plans and shoot a movie. Sort of like we say to students sometimes, well, just go make a movie then. So according to the novice, Varda, she said, they even knew where to rent cameras and how to borrow lights. Like, so again, this shows a sort of naivete, if we can believe her. She was just impressed this young couple could help her. So they were very assured, even careless, in just telling her, go forth, make a feature film. And I think they deserve a lot of credit for that sort of spirit of the new wave of just saying, yeah, there are a lot of rules and we don't know all everything, but let's just do it. So they really were contributing members to that spirit and really helped get this movie made. They saw the barriers to new talent and unconventional productions as artificial limitations at the time that should be just ignored or at least confronted. And Carlos Villard-de-Beau, became Varda's assistant director for tonight's film, while his young wife was a production assistant juggling many practical tasks to help get this film made. Now, what finally got Varda's project moving for good seems to have been the unfortunate death of her father and the resulting small inheritance she received. So as Varda explains it, at least, she inherited roughly $4,000 herself, borrowed another $6,500 from her mother. She found some other financial resources and things she'd saved up, and she raised a total of $13,000 to spend. Now, she set aside $7,000 to promise the crew and cast, so that the total on paper was $20,000 to make this movie, but she didn't have the $7,000 yet for the cast and crew, and that's where the notion of a cooperative came from. And I do want to point out, I mean, this is like before, you know, the New Wave guys are trying to figure out how to do it. She's trying to figure out, how do I just do this with very little money? And as you know, I mean, she's now using Kickstarter, and she's still kind of looking at interesting ways at age 88 to get her movies made in kind of unconventional ways, and also to kind of spread the risk, I think, a little bit sometimes on certain projects as well. So by the end, what she did then finally was find cast and crew willing to work for expenses, but with contracts that divided future earnings among everybody involved, depending on their contributions. So for instance, camera operator Paul Sulinac, who was the oldest member of the crew at age 32, he got 3 shares of eventual box office money. The assistant director got 19 shares, etc. Varda managed to talk TNP, the Theatre National Populaire actors she'd met, Sylvia Montfort and Philippe Noiret, into joining this highly unusual project, again with just food basically and somewhere to stay while they shot the movie over a short period of time. Now, the average French feature this time cost close to $150,000. I should have gotten that up earlier. So the average feature is about $150,000, 10 times the cost of La Pointe Courte. But what's also really important to notice is that, yeah, the New Wave films, Quatre Cents Coups, Breathless, Le Beau Serge, Cousins, things like that are in the $50,000 to $80,000 range. So it's still really cheap by what's going to be cheap New Wave standards in just a couple of years. Now, it's also worth noting that when the New Wave directors did make their cheap films by the late 50s, they would benefit from new rules from the Centre National de Cinématographie, the CNC, National Organization, new rules for quality film and funding opportunities that were not available in 1954 for Agnès Varda and 55 when she was shooting. And Varda's film was unapproved by the CNC, so she could never get aid. So her movie was even more radical than a lot of theirs in many ways. So by all accounts, Varda was a truly naive filmmaker, I do think. She wasn't naive in lots of ways, but about cinema, she seems to have been. So in the most positive sense of the term, she was kind of naive about what she was doing, I think. She had only seen a few films, as mentioned, and was basing her project really more on literary, photographic, artistic influences, and not necessarily on cinematic knowledge for her context. A few years later, at the height of the New Wave, Jean-Luc Godard would claim he was glad now that he'd been rejected by and never gotten into a film school like IDEC, because then he would have learned how to hang lights and where to place a camera just like everybody else, and he would edit movies like everybody else. So he was proud that he was untrained, he used to say. Well, Varda was doing this before him. So I think, I think it's really important to notice she was very isolated from film practice in lots of ways, and really does anticipate some of the New Wave members who are a little more blustery about what they were doing that was so special. And she did not have a backlog of favorite directors in the back of her mind and scenes to emulate, so she's not going to ever set her camera up and say, I wonder how Hitchcock would shoot this scene, or what would Jean Renoir do here, or what would De Sica do in a neorealist film? So she's also not really, doesn't have conscious quotes, although she's going to be inspired by painters and novelists and poets and other things as well. So she really was, I think, creating her own cinema. And that's why it's really important when André Bazin, in the first article about this 25-year-old woman, says she's an auteur. I mean, he's just going to give this, you know, she is special. And I think this post-production phase is really important to understanding why tonight's movie looks so unusual in lots of ways. It's not just personal, but she's kind of feeling her way here on instinct as much as anything. Now, Varda's remarkable independence earned immediate praise from a wide variety of film critics who situated her unusual practice in the context of Alexander Ostrouk's famous article, Birth of the New Avant-Garde, La Caméra Stylo, from Écran. And I think, Yes. Okay. I missed one of my cues. Now, Ostrug had written about in 1948, he'd written that there were a few brave souls out there helping revitalize narrative cinema and turning it in new directions. But he also predicted that the great movies that are coming in the next few years are going to have a new cohort of young filmmakers who express their thoughts directly onto the film stock, much like novelists and philosophers. Cinema could tackle any subject, and the camera was the pen of contemporary times. Now, Ostrug inspired a new generation of young critics to search out new talent with new unconventional styles. So it also really helped prepare a new generation of critics to be looking for unusual stuff rather than dismiss it. So picking up this call to arms, Truffaut was very typical, writing, "Young filmmakers must stop walking in the steps of old directors." What's also important is that she's going to talk about her work as a ciné-écriture, that I'm writing with cinema. She doesn't talk about a script necessarily. She likes to talk about ciné-écriture early on in her career, saying, what I do is I write with images and sounds. So here again, Wild Palms, we'll talk about in a second again, is one of the influences by Faulkner. She goes and talks to the fishermen about how they make nets and what things like that. She's influenced by Brecht, as she likes to say, and Jean Villard. She didn't read Ostrug that we know of, but she never says cinema. She never talks about, and that was really influenced by cinema, which is going to be important as well. So her script and concept are based in part, as it says here, on the divided narrative form of William Faulkner's Wild Palms, which alternates stories of a renegade romantic couple's tale with that of a flood and some southern prison inmates. Now her story, however, intercut a couple in crisis in La Pointe Courte with the seemingly unrelated daily challenges of the fishing families around them. After pondering how to proceed and with no real clear roadmap in sight, she decided to auto-produce the movie, setting up her own production company, Ciné Tamaris, as you know, that still exists today. Now, though Agnès Varda was plunging rashly into production, she at least did contact the CNC, organization, to look into what kind of regulations are there to make in movies. What should I know about this stuff before she made it? Well, the CNC requires licenses. And for a short film producer, to be a producer of short films, you pay $2,000 a year. For a feature, it's $10,000. Well, she's got $13,000. She can't afford $10,000. So she pays the $2,000 license to make a short film. So if she does make a film, she's figuring, well, if it's going to be a feature like I hope, I'll just appeal to them and say, wow, I made a feature instead. That didn't work later on. It eventually proved unsuccessful. Without their approval, she could never find a commercial distributor. So from the start, she realized she was embarking on a sort of risky venture. But she and her crew forged ahead rather than being deterred by the hurdles built into the system of 1954 and 55 French film production. Now, unfortunately, by the time they were ready to make the movie, Varda and her crew realized they could not afford a camera with sync sound. She nonetheless required the actors, Philippe Noiret and Sylvie Montfort, to memorize their lines and speak them clearly, while Jane Villard-Debeau took notes. Varda also interacted a great deal with the local families, as mentioned, staging them in their own environment. She benefited from their generosity, borrowing boats, invading their homes with her camera, etc. And everybody's voice then would be, including all the locals, was post-dubbed later in Paris, a strategy that it disappointed many of the local people when they got to finally see themselves in the movie that some other Southerner was putting their voice in back in Paris. Now, during post-production, Varda had most of the voices, however, close-miked, so like here. So even when characters are walking along on a gravel path away from the camera, the voices don't get necessarily louder as they get closer to the camera for a realistic soundscape, but they tend to be very close mic'd, like they're always just sitting in a recording studio like they were. Whether this was intentional, as she likes to claim now later on, I decided the sound should be right up front, or whatever choice, but it does make sometimes not a tension necessarily, but a sort of strange notion that the words even seem more dreamy because they don't seem to fit the space, which is so visually important on the screen. There's a great shot, and there's another version of it in here too, of Varda standing on a box trying to look through the viewfinder for a high angle shot. So she's really engaged in the process as well as they go. So during post-production, as mentioned, they shot it close mic'd. And while Philippe Noiret had never acted in a movie before, and he was really eager, one reason he took this on, this is his first motion picture role, was he wanted to learn about how do you make movies. So Noiret had no experience. Montfort had actually been in a couple screen roles, including Jean Delannoy, one of the quality French directors, movies, and had an important part in a Jean Cocteau film. Well, one additional motivation for her choosing Mofor as an actress was that she reminded her of a character from Della Francesca play or a painting, and Varda emphasized what she called that blank stare. So that blank stare that she wants to kind of preserve in Montfort, she wants her to sort of, you know, don't look like you know what you're saying, just look stare, helps reinforce that sort of ambiguity of a sort of art film character, or at least also what's puzzling about the characters tonight too. Further, in preparing the actors, and this is one, Varda chose to de-dramatize the acting and the delivery of the dialogue. She was inspired by Jean Vilar again and his directing experiments that aimed to get away from a sort of psychological realism, but not be a real radical break and rupture either, but something sort of a middle ground, a sort of different kind of performance style. So for La Pointe Courte, the dialogue would often prove quite poetic and far from natural, and the close miking reinforces that, I think, while the actor's presentations was meant to be flat and declamatory. As we'll see, many of the reviewers were puzzled or put off by some of the resulting performances and the contrast between the natural environment and the natural rhythm of the villagers versus the dialogue. The Positif review noted that the characters express themselves aesthetically by their position on the screen as if some kind of marionettes. So again, it's not a real natural, not just the bottom two pictures, but it's not a real natural necessarily way of presenting characters in the screen, much less with the sound. So throughout her career, Varda has always looked for a wide range of cultural connections, especially in art history as motivation, even in her acting choices. And the theatrical influence was also made clear when she told Jacques Ledoux at the Brussels Cinematheque premiere that she opted for a situation that resembled opera. And she says, rather than planting themselves and singing, my actors plant themselves and speak. She also refused to name the couple in the script. There's not, we don't know what their character names are. A trait that's going to be very common of the nouveau roman, the new novels of the era. In a Robrier novel, you don't necessarily know the name of the characters either. And that's a trait that is going to help make less individualized, less psychologically determined characters as well, I think. They're just figures on the screen sometimes. Noiré in particular, he was very frustrated by the on-set experience. As he says, Agnes did not really understand how actors work, and she was more preoccupied with the formal structure of her film than with our performances. In fact, he said, she did not spend much time with us. But also, I had no idea, no point of comparison of what a normal film was like. I found out much later how different this experience was than any other in filmmaking. End quote. Well, only after Varda had indeed completed shooting all the footage for La Pointe Courte and returned to Paris for post-production of dubbing in the sound, did she come to realize that she needs an editor. Fortunately, she was turned on to Alain René. He was intrigued by this adventurous project and its striking images. She had to show him stuff. And she doesn't have any money. You know, would you like to edit my footage? And, you know, you get future profits. He had to be convinced. And most of his own films up to this point had been documentaries, very fascinating documentaries, certainly. And some about art, just like some of her films are going to be about art as well. But he wanted to move into fiction, so he saw this as a good opportunity for him to start to learn about fiction filmmaking and storytelling, etc., through editing. So he signed on, even though it was a very daunting task. She had 9 hours of footage. Her plan was to make a three-hour La Pointe Courte. he talked her out of the three-hour version. But he also, and as she says in her autobiography, he said, it's an unusual project. It must be respected as such. And that's one of the things to watch as you go through here. What do you do as an editor looking at these really long takes sometimes? There are really no kind of conventional establishing shot and cut-ins necessarily. So he has to decide what to do. But anyway, here he worked for lunch. She promised to give him lunch. He came every day at the same time. He left at the same time. But he decided that he wanted to preserve some of her quirkiness, but then also add other things. I'm just going to show you like two examples of things you might not even notice as the film is going, but this is kind of how she set up scenes. Now, on the top left, you've got a woman in a boat who's talking to the two policemen and this guy. She has a conversation. The next cut, on the top right, they turn around and start to walk away while she says something else. So it's like she's set her camera in these two like different spaces, but it's not like anybody else would set up a conversation shot. Same thing here. There's a beautiful, stunning shot where this guy's going out to sea, and actually it's often everybody's favorite shot, right? It's got this boat, this sort of long rod that's going to bounce up at us, and then somebody's going to walk past with another pole going this way. It's like an Eisenstein shot. It's incredible conflict of movement and stuff. And then you cut to a reverse shot of the guy once the guy's out in his boat, looking back, and then you see these two guys over on the wall, and one of them's got a tall pole, so I think that was him over there. But you've got these shots, they just don't fall together. It's not continuity classical editing, needless to say, but it's also just a very kind of strange kind of photographer's notion of how to set up space. And Rene wanted to really work with that. So anyway, he taught her how to organize the rushes. They hired an assistant director, Anne Sarraute, whose mother was a famous novelist, and they set about the editing as well. And Renee also started at this point to really expose her to choices in editing by taking her to the Cinematheque, showing her other movies like La Terra Trema. Everybody said, well, this is just like this Terra Trema movie where it takes place in a fishing village in Italy. And she's like, what are you talking about? So then she would go watch that. So during the production, post-production process, she saw some more movies that he would help justify or say, now should we edit it like this or should we continue your own rhythm? Now visually, La Pointe Courte, and I'm sorry, so I go till... Oh, like hung at 9:10. It's all right. I was going to double check these things, but we didn't have much time with my rushed arrival. And I'm going to show you two others. It does have there's an upsetting shot here. Now these two go side. They go actually top to bottom. So at one point they're going to have a conversation. Yeah, when I began to love you, he says, and you cut to a shot where like you can't even see initially what's going on. It's just sort of an empty shot. And gradually you'll see this, like, a crab kind of walk into it. Then you cut back to another kind of weird reverse shot where they both sort of have a conversation where she's just sort of turned the camera a little bit. And then as she says, you can't tell me our love hasn't changed, they cut to a real dead cat that she'd found on the rocks at some point. So sometimes you get these very strange, almost like weird metaphor, because it's like corny editing. Other times it's just, so these kind of scenes where, do we leave it in one really long take? Do we cut two long takes together? Do we cut in sort of metaphorical little objects? It's a really kind of halting kind of editing that is really unlike anybody else's, I think. So anyway, visually, La Pointe Courte reveals itself right away as an unusual project. It owes a lot to her photographic experience. Her collaboration with Rene, though, in the editing, I think, is really amazing. He often chose to leave a lot of these beautiful long takes intact. And the strange visual quality of this film, she's going to exploit the local light, the setting, objects like a dead cat washed up, actors, inhabitants, as if they were simultaneously carefully crafted elements of the mise-en-scene and chance-found objects. So the camera sometimes will just take off, seemingly unmotivated, only to come to rest on a really poignant object or action. And I don't know if you've noticed this in other films you've seen this year, but a lot of times in later when she likes to set up tracks and have these sort of arcing shots. And it looks like, well, where the heck's it going? And then you realize, oh my God, what a beautiful camera movement. Finally, it justifies itself by the end. Already you're going to see some really neat little tracking shots as this goes on. So the same thing with here, you're going to have the camera take off sometimes. Other shots are going to be static and seem empty, like the one with the crab, and then suddenly it wanders in, or other times a character will come in. And all this leads Andre Bazin to really just say, what unifies this is the person behind the camera, the editing. It's Varda. It's the auteur. So for him, this is just a major find. He's really going to be one of her great advocates early on. And in fact, he's the one who tells Agnes Varda, this is an amazing film. Go to Cannes, rent a room, and just show it. Show it out of competition. And that's where those first reviews come from, is she doesn't get to show it officially anywhere. She just can do a private screening because she can't legally show it yet. And so in June 1955, she shows it out of competition at Cannes, which is not that usual, not that normal back then. And in his initial review, he said, yeah, it's that total freedom of the style, so rare in cinema. We're in the presence of this work that only obeys the dreams. So he was not as troubled by the two distinct visual styles of the villagers versus the people that you're going to notice as some other people were. Pierre Billard of Cahiers says, well, there's some, these protagonists only say, oh, I'm sorry, the guy from Pierre Billard is going to say, this is just embarrassingly static cinema, whereas Bazin is going to say, no, these are the characters who only say essential things that are also useless, just like in our dreams. So Varda's characters are typically framed from a variety of extreme camera angles and with a striking depth of field. Her strategy seemed to later reviewers to celebrate Lumiere shots and his cinematograph, Jean Vigo, as well as the neorealists especially. But they're also really just personal choices. They're not New Wave style references. And Varda's human figures are often paired with beautifully photographed objects that share the composition. So even when the main characters are alone, for example, in bed at night, they might refer to the shadows and reflections playing on the ceiling of their room. The movie's about the space of La Pointe-Courte. It's about its cats, its inhabitants, its fluttering laundry, and these sort of labyrinths of drying fishnets as they go. And one of the scenes just to watch for, too, at one point, the couple's going to have this conversation, and the whole time in the back, there's this black cat kind of strutting around, stretching, and I can't tell, watch for it. Is she kind of making fun of this couple? Like, you're talking about this stuff and we got something. Is it somehow making a metaphorical point about like the black cat, the doom of their relationship? It's really hard for me to tell. It's hard to tell what her perspective is in some of these things. It's a very sort of personal style, but I can never tell. And another thing to talk about afterwards, does anything this couple sees around them affect them? Does it affect their outcome in any way? And it's really hard to tell. Some reviewers thought it did. Others thought it didn't. So, just really quickly, as mentioned, the plot structure is famously divided in two pieces, but while Wild Palms by Faulkner has flashbacks, internal monologues, you really get to understand the characters, we don't get that in Varda. So she might use the two pieces of Faulkner, but she doesn't use any of his characterization. Instead, she's going to drop us into a binary plot structure with very little information on these characters. We just get bits and pieces of information as the characters talk. So we gather information slowly as it goes. So we don't get to use our usual hypothesis making about what a character is. Usually the primacy effect, we say, oh, I understand this is a good person or a bad person, and then you test your hypotheses. It's very difficult in this film. She's going to refrain from giving us enough character information sometimes early on to decide what we're supposed to think of these people. So there's confusion, there's some shifting expectations as the film goes along. Now she cites Brecht as another factor in these choices. She says, you start listening to the couple, and then bam, stop. You distance yourself, and I show you the fishermen and their social lives, and then bam, stop. I'll distance you and go back to the couple. But she might say that, but it's impossible to watch a movie and not create characters. It's impossible to watch a movie and not try to connect those pieces rather than see them as just separate like she seems to pretend we can. So I'm really interested in how she's going to organize this stuff. And one of the things that does come up in this and other films she makes is she does see the difference between male and female sides of the island. The lighter side are the women and the women's work, this more collective, and the men who are often shown in darkness. Now, the clear differences between Varda's two plot lines place unusual strains on our ability to recognize character traits and assess their motivations. Usually, we engage with fictional characters to the extent that the narrator allows us to be aligned with their motivations. To fully identify with these characters, we should have to understand and share some of their goals. So if a husband, in any movie, wants to remain married and their marriage is on the rocks, he should give us some pretty clear notion about what's at stake for him. He should convince the audience as well as his wife maybe of his merits and his feelings. Watch whether that happens much in this or in which scenes you start to feel empathy. When do we get engaged emotionally with these characters? She really does avoid the conventions of psychological realism quite often in this film, and that I think is what makes the viewing of it that much more interesting, is we can't decide sometimes where are we supposed to anticipate what comes. So as mentioned, André Bazin becomes a big advocate, the revelation of the festival. He says, go show your movie out of competition. And then he's going to write, what the great thing at Cannes Film Festival was, this movie shown out of competition. It played later on along with a Vigo short, in fact, when it did get to play in Paris. Well, anyway, after the premiere, I'll just get right now to wrap up. At its first premiere in Cannes in 1955, Le Monde, the mainstream newspaper critic, came to it and argued, it is no longer impossible to hope that young talent, now reduced to silence, will soon find an opportunity to express themselves. The cinema will no longer be simply a heavy industrial machine churning out distractions, but a mirror reflecting the diverse ideas and styles. This talented young woman is sounding the first note in what promises to be a great symphony. So already they're gonna be celebrating her. The other one from the other part of the article says, yeah, it's like she's working with a camera stilo, a pen, and a palette knife. She's like an artist with her camera. Claude Marillac in Le Figaro, La Pointe Court wakes up and revitalizes cinema. It offers a new genre, few precedents on the screen. So people are really recognizing that this is an unusual voice, Agnès Varda's film. It's an unusual project. She was seen early on as the vanguard, really, of a new kind of film practice. People were looking at, just to remind you about the new wave, there's a new wave in theater, there's a new novel coming out. People are waiting for a new generation cinema in the 50s to come along, and they're watching for any kind of indication. And this young woman comes out of no place and ends up doing it. François Truffaut is a little less convinced. But there is this idea, it's her pure expression outside of commercial considerations. Again, she doesn't have the right permits. She doesn't have any union positions. She can't show this thing legally. She didn't have the permission from the CNC. She didn't have the right license. She didn't use a single union person. Later on, when the French New Wave guys, and I'll use Claude Chabrol as an example, Claude Chabrol makes Le Beau Serge. Did you guys... That's the one where Kelly Conway was here. Yeah, Le Beau Serge, the first film by Claude Chabrol, which launches the new wave for a lot of people. He goes to the town where he spent his World War II years and goes back and shoots there, just like she goes to La Pointe Courte. He uses local friends, his friend who's a real baker. He has played the baker in the movie. So he has real friends from that era be in the movie. He makes it really cheap, but he goes to the CNC first, and he gets them... He gets permission to not use all the union people he needs to have. He gets gets some funding and aid ahead of time from them. So even when they're going to model themselves on Varda, they're going to avoid her sort of rash decisions. They're going to work with the CNC, and by that point, the CNC is going to be much more flexible in order to work with them. So I'll wrap up, and we'll talk more about other reviews and stuff afterwards. Let me just say a couple quick things. Vince mentioned that Varda says this was a terrible flop. Well, there's a joke for, I don't know if people know about the Velvet Underground, the first Velvet Underground album, there's an old saying that it only sold 100 copies, but 99 of the people who bought that got inspired to go out and start their own rock bands. The same thing happens here. When she has these small little screenings, it's not just the new generation of critics who are going to show up, it's also the people who are going to go on and found the new wave, and writers like Marguerite Duras, who's going to work with Renée for Hiroshima Mon Amour. So a lot of those kind of people are going to be watching this movie, inspired by this movie, think about how they too could tell personal stories. So even though it wasn't a commercial hit in lots of ways, it is indeed going to be an important film. I'm going to skip over... Truffaut and just say a couple more quick things. You're going to see Floating Laundry. She's going to pick some of these things up in her other films. Men at Work versus Women at Work. There's going to be things that from this film that you've seen in other films you've seen by her as well. In Le Bonheur, there's the famous montage where the women's hands are working and then the man goes off to he's either sawing or he goes off to work, and it equates him with a lion on the prowl kind of thing. Men's space, women's space is going to be established in this film as well. La Terra Trema is just to show images for people who haven't seen it, for the movie you're about to see, with empty boats, people on location. Deep space is what people are going to connect it to. But finally, the last thing I want to say is Hiroshima Mon Amour. René goes on to make his own first feature film, and a lot of what he learns in editing and working and storytelling with Agnès Varda, he and Marguerite Duras are going to use again in Hiroshima Mon Amour. And if you know the movie, you've got another stilted, kind of stiff couple having these very intense conversations. It gets more passionate than La Pointe Courte might, but they're going to be wandering around having these conversations with, you know, actors and things going on in Hiroshima behind them, much like the fishermen in the movie today. At one point, they're going to get swept up in the crowd, much like in this movie today. They're going to have these very carefully posed things. So I think a lot of what she did is going to influence her later films, but a lot of the other people around her. So let me just wrap up by saying... one of the other reviews that came out was by Cahiers du Cinéma co-founder Jacques Daniel Valcroze, and he wrote in 1956 at that first screening in Paris, that she got to show it four Tuesdays in a row as a cine club. And François Truffaut even said, go see the movie, but stay for the debate afterwards. He says, I don't understand this movie, you know, but the debate is really going to help. And Daniel Valcroze says, this is the most earnest, least selfish French film of the year, which is to say it's honest, it's translucent. Start your year with a pure soul. Go see La Pointe Courte. So thanks for your attention, and I really do look forward to any kind of reactions afterwards. Thank you.
Yeah, please welcome again Richard Neupert and Vincent Seliger.
Okay, let me first thank you again for that wonderful introduction. It's been a long while since I've gone into a film screening so well prepared. Knowing all the background about the production history and also knowing what happened to the film after it came out and how it was championed by Bazin. Actually had this important impact on the subsequent developments, particularly in cinema, maybe also in the Nouveau Roman. That's been extremely instructive, and I'm particularly happy that your suggested reading sort of confirms my intuitions that I had when I first saw the film some while back, that in a way she defined the idiom of a certain type of filmmaking, which Duras and René and a few others further developed. So it's really a key moment in the development of new French cinema.
Yeah, and I think one thing to keep in mind is we in genres, we talk about the avant-garde, experimental cinema versus narrative, etc. But in the 40s and 50s, there was a lot of concern in French cinema about really this notion of a new avant-garde. And it wasn't like non-narrative necessarily. It wasn't political necessarily. It really had to do with just, you know, really sort of experimenting with narrative modes. And I think she really fit into that in a way. And again, I think, you know, not necessarily consciously. Other people were trying to be like the new person on the block who can do a sort of avant-garde narrative. They wanted to fit into what Ostrouk is saying and what Cahiers du Cinéma is saying. And she was just, again, I think, you know, already because of these other influences, on a pathway that would bring her closer to that goal. Mm-hmm. But,
ambiguity is an important part of it. We were just, before the screening, just briefly talking about the ending, which is sort of an open ending, or
yes.
Is it?
So can I just, how many people have never seen it before? Oh my gosh, great.
Pretty much
okay.
Everyone.
So I'm curious, what the first time I saw this movie, I just thought something was, it was a 35 millimeter print at the Cinematheque or someplace, and I thought something was missing. I thought, wait a minute, we see them heading off through the crowd, and then we see some people get in a boat, and we expect them maybe to get in the boat to get over across that water to the gare, to the train station, which is, right? I mean, it's a really kind of, at least to me, very puzzling ending. So yeah, the whole notion of the last dialogue is all about, should we drown these cats or not? Mm. Is this kid going to get one of the kittens? And then just random dialogue that seems, it's like a Dos Passos novel or something, just random dialogues of people on a train, and then them, what time do we get to Paris? So I guess we're supposed to think they're on that train, and yes, they've gotten over there, but a couple of days she might complain about their relationship again. So it's, to me at least, I don't know, and I've got a whole book about endings, I don't know what to make of this one. It is very open in some ways. Mm. A lot of the stories of the people, the village, I mean, I still don't know, what do they think about the water? I mean, some of them really think the water's safe and they should be able to fish where it's illegal to fish, I guess. And others seem resigned to the fact that it's bacteria, and others say, well, somebody would have died by now. I mean, if this is a classical Hollywood Moore movie, somehow the couple would have something to do with that. Mm-hmm. Like she'd say, oh, by the way, I'm a scientist and I can test this water, or, yeah, you know, or she could be a nurse and help, you know, take care of some of the poor kids, or, I mean, there's, yeah, nothing to bring those things together, but it, right, also, there's nothing gets resolved. We just have a sense they're going to keep trying to fish where they're not supposed to fish. It's still not clear to me, why don't they want to fish farther away, and what can they fish and what can't they? That stuff is just not clarified. Mm. But yeah, the couple's concerns also,
so
are just sort of
never clear why Raphael is taken away to prison, for instance.
Yeah, so he's, I mean, they've seen a bunch of boats going in, they catch him, and, oh, well, if you were really fishing where you say you were, which is apparently legal, you still can't bring them on shore, so we'll catch you for that, even though we know you were fishing where you're not supposed to be. Mm. It seems, right, it's so they're all playing games with each other. Yeah. So, yeah, it's a... It doesn't really wrap stuff up, and it just seems kind of unsettling. And then we go back like a coda, or I don't know, some kind of bracketing thing. We go back to the opening music, and now we see the guys who played the opening music when we saw the piece of wood, who are playing again at the end. So it's a very formal opening closing that doesn't, it brackets the film, but it doesn't really complete it, resolve it. There's no termination effect, like, oh, yeah, we know they're going to be fine in the future or they're not. We know that people are going to be better off or not. We know this guy's got to go back to prison for days. Then he's got to go into the service, apparently. Then he might come back and marry Anna. Mm. So everything's just kind of on hold at this end, I think.
Yeah. I like the notion of game playing. I think that, you know, in my own contribution to the series, I try to create a connection to Kino and the Ulipo literature movement, which is basically very much about formal play and about game playing and about, you know, literature as game playing. So I think that sort of fits in there. One last remark before we open the discussion to the public. What, you know, your presentation brought out to me, and as I was watching the film again, is how much of a film about cats this is.
She loves her cats.
Yeah.
But also, and they, I mean, one of the complaints that Philippe Noiret had was that she spent more time wrangling cats than talking to the actors. So that whole notion of, yes. Yeah, and also just that
cats,
one...
Cats
that one,
are just more unwieldy than actors, you know. It's like,
There's some great shots, but that one, not just the one where the black one, it is seem like an ominous thing, but there's that one where it's just like an Ajé photo or something of just an empty garage with that cat just looking at us in the back. Doesn't, you know, you can put it anywhere in the movie. So there's a lot of those kind of shots, and the same with the couple wandering. We get, you know, they're just wandering, and the couple they're apparently staying with, even says they're just wandering on like a couple of dogs. You call this a vacation? But there is that sense of just that, you know, there's something about the meandering that gets you where you're going, which, and you don't realize it. And I think she loves cats, so there must be some intelligence. It's not like they're a pest or something out there. But yeah, you're right. It is a love of cats. Yeah. And one last review I want to mention was La Croix Rouge. So the Catholic newspaper in France reviewed it right away. And they're the one that didn't pay much attention to like the poverty and misery of the working class and the fishermen. They suggested young couples who are having some problems after a few years of marriage, and it doesn't seem like things are as bright as, should go watch this very frank movie. So the reviewer for the Catholic newspaper actually, they you know, saw it as sort of an earnest movie about the difficulties of young couples. And I'm like, really? Like, what's the point? You know, what would you get out of this if you're a couple in trouble and you watched it? I don't know. It just seems... So anyway, I still don't know what Varda wants us to think of the couple, but I really was surprised this reviewer saying, go see this if your marriage is in trouble. But anyway. But yeah, any kind of comments or questions about anything?
Well, you know, he clearly... you know, came to a certain conclusion as far as the ending is concerned, you know.
That's right.
To him, the ending certainly meant that they sorted out their troubles. Yeah. Do we have questions from the audience at this point?
Yeah, come please. To you with the mic.
Pedro Palma.
And it's far away.
I can go this way and be shorter.
Yeah.
And I apologize. I think allergies or something after I get that the train.
Thank you very much for your insights. I got a question regarding the music, because we heard a lot about the pictures and the influences of the painting and photography. So do you know anything about the music she's influenced by, she chosen for this film?
Yeah, the music is another thing that, with her frequent visits, she was also wanted to have things local. So she did meet this group. And that's one of the things, and especially after all the movies you've seen, the notions, I think, throughout her career of you know, her writing dialogue maybe for songs, but then, you know, and having someone else write the music. But like in The Gleaners, too, where she writes that rap song, but she finds just some kids on the street, you know, pounded on buckets and uses them. She sort of finds the music. So that idea is that she wanted to really include as much of the culture as she could. So not only did she love the jousts when she'd been out there, she says, I got to get these in my movie, which don't, you know, they help Raphael's case, I guess, but don't really advance things. But the same with the music. She discovered, you know, this to her is part of the memory of her childhood, these festivities, the dances. But yeah, she wanted the local music. But that's another one of the problems was, like, the guy at the end who sings, and all the ladies kind of make fun of him at the end. You know, like, she's got the real local guy singing, but then she goes to Paris and has somebody else sing the same song. But still, she's very influenced by the local sound as much as the look. But yeah, you gotta hopefully.
Yeah, can
more.
I just follow up on that though? Please. Because that goes to the That goes to the music at the beginning and at the end. But the other music in the soundtrack is you know, oboe and clarinet. It's kind of jazzy music. It sounds a lot like René's music that he used in Night and Fog and maybe some other movies too. Was there any
kind of great observation? I'm not sure who, like, in the script stuff, she talks about music, but it's not as, so I don't know when, because it really was a double post-production process where she came back and started doing the sound, and Pierre Cast and some other people helped with that at a different studio to do the sound, and when she brought on René, and there were some friends of his, so I think the connection to Alain and René is actually brilliant, yes. I think, so it is a collection of stuff, and mm-hmm. part of that she puts in at the end, some she anticipated, but she knew when she went down in there she wanted some music from the people of that place.
I just had one more quick observation. It seemed to me that there was kind of a key line in the middle of the film when the male character, Philip Noiret's character, said, now you know half of my life. This is the other half of my life. And it, in a way, to me, it referred to the way that the film is bifurcated. You know, so
yeah, there's a lot about divisions and halves. They split their faces, but they got two stories. Mm-hmm. So you're right. I think that division that we can never know the other half. And even at the end, when she says something about, and even our secrets in a couple, people don't know if they're like happy or sad.
But to me, everything is kind of the village is half of his life, you know?
Yes, I mean, that's true. Also is just not explained very much, right? I mean, so his father died. What's he do now? You know, does he work with his hands? Is he an attorney? You know, we don't really know anything about these people. Like, what did he learn from La Pointe Courte and growing up with a boat builder's father, as boat builder's a father, that has somehow influenced him? Or has he lost all that and that's why he has to come back? Like, what's he getting out of it? Because again, we said, there's not much to see here. And then other times, everything is here. Everything goes flip-flopping in this thing. It's not game-like all the time, but there is this sense of, you know, I'm not sure he could even put it in words. He keeps trying over and over what La Pointe Courte is to him, but that's a good point. Mm.
And there's another phrase, I want to say it. They talk too much to be happy. I love that.
and when the locals saw this the first time, and she does the premiere all the time, when the locals did get to see the movie, their first complaint was, you know, what are these two jackasses walking through our movie? They just, you know, they wanted everything about the fishing community, and they didn't want the others. And then other reviews just talked about the relationship, like the Catholic review, yeah. And didn't really care about the locals.
Yeah, thank you very much. I liked very much the introduction because you also gave the names. This is what I criticized with another professor from Britain and so on. So it's very naughty to say, well, I can send you all the names I mentioned in my lecture. This happened the other day at university and so on. So another point, I had a very strong feeling of suspense throughout the entire story. I don't know how this comes about. And some things reminded me of a Greek tragedy or game playing. It's all a bit bizarre, but it's also very thrilling to me. So that's my feeling. And in some way, the movie reminded me also of Italian movies, you see, which were the four movies she saw. Because here we saw also a similar movie, you know, with couples running around. You mentioned this before, but it's so strange. Did she see Italian movies?
At different times, and others, she might have a better list. I mean, at different times, she said different movies. And she'd say, well, I kind of remember seeing Citizen Kane. And like, well, that doesn't help. she claimed she'd never seen any Italian films, but she would just say three or four movies, and it's only later she met people and watched the Cahiers. So I'm not sure, but yeah, I think even the inspectors in the first scene, in their suits, they look like they came out of some Italian movie, right? They look like she's seen some Italian movie where the inspector guy's like, they try to go in the door, and then, no, we got to stop. So I But you're right about certainly the classic sort of theatrical, there's a sort of Greek drama and tragic kind of sense in the background. But there's also like no suspense in this classic way, I think. For example, I'm just to say why this isn't to me a typical new wave movie kind of. If Truffaut was going to do some of these scenes, you know, oh, the Coast Guard's getting closer. Oh, the Coast Guard's got a new boat, or the health officials, you know. The little girl on the bridge, where is she? Like those kind of scenes. Yeah, don't worry about anything. The little girl's watching. They're out fishing where they're not supposed to. It didn't build, doesn't build that kind of classical suspense, but you have the suspense like what's going to happen with the couple, with the people. It's a real general kind of sense,
there
I think.
There seem to be so many hazards and dangers and so on, you know. That yeah. could always happen something strange and so on. And I had another point, and this is, you said she invented her own stories. Can you give an example for this? Thank you.
Invented her own stories in terms of...
You said about her own history.
In terms of... Have you got I would just say she kind of repackages things. One of the brilliant things about Agnes Varda, and I think there are very few other people like this, who don't just keep moving forward and changing herself and what she's doing, but keeps going back and sort of repackaging, repurposing, and Kelly Conway certainly worked that into her book quite a bit, how things come back in different ways. But even just this notion that oh, yeah, I knew all along I was going to make this movie. But also just, I don't want to say too much because she's a wonderful, valuable historian of her work, but I think it kind of shapes how everybody has to react to everything she does. So she makes a documentary about her life and explains certain situations, but then won't talk about others. So I think she really shapes the discourse. So she shapes the history. She shapes a lot of the things about her life that she wants to keep... She markets herself and brands herself in a way that has changed, I think, certain ways across the time. At certain times, she was much less of a feminist. You know, oh, I don't want to be thought of as a woman director. Then a few years later, I've always seen myself as a feminist. I'm a real, you know. So it's just, it kind of depends on the times and stuff. But she's just very, very good about branding herself, reworking herself, making the discussion, the bonus material on her movies. And I think, I can't think of anybody else in the world. She's not only the most important woman filmmaker ever. I can't think of another individual auteur who spends as much time looking at their past work, making sure that it's available and accessible, giving bonus material on it while she's making new work. So it's, and even she says now in a lot of interviews lately, I don't really remember certain, I don't remember that. You know, I don't remember, like, where did she get the 16mm camera? She doesn't remember. Like, who gave her a camera? How'd she have a camera that first time she went down there? So certain things she doesn't remember, but then can get reworked into new stories, I guess I'd put it that way. But again, I think she's amazing. It's just hard to work on somebody who is very controlling and concerned about how she's represented, and who wouldn't be. But think of most directors you really, really care about. They're not that sort of, I don't want to say possessive, but just, you know, concerned with how everybody reads everything they were. So somebody wants to make a documentary about her. She says, no way, I'll make my own documentary about me. So I think that's just a really wonderfully rare kind of trait, but it makes it harder to work on her because you have to kind of always know she's looking at everything you're doing and approving it in some ways.
Which goes hand in hand with her utter and complete refusal to ever read anything that is being written about her. You know, I mean, when she was here, she made it a point again to say, you know, poor Kelly Conway, I really like her, but I can't read her book.
I don't know if I would...
Yeah, but she makes it a point to say
the
that.
First time I met Agnes, the first time I met Agnes was in 2002. There was the Kelly Conway at Madison organized a conference, and I got to give the lead paper. It was great. Varda was going to be there. It was like this huge thing. And my New Wave book had just come out. It was published by that university press. I hadn't even seen it yet. It was on a table outside, apparently, while I was talking, and she came in the middle, and she made some great comments at the end of the talk. But then she came up and said, and has my book in her hand. And I'm like, oh, my God, I hadn't even seen it yet. And she's saying, you know, you quote somebody saying such and such about me. So it was like, you know, she'd already found the book while I was talking, looked herself up, and was ready to say, you shouldn't quote this person because I don't like what he says about me. So I.
Which proves your point.
She's a very good friend. I just adore her. I really do. I mean, there's nobody like her. Yeah, on a personal note, I have a special needs daughter, and Agnes has been so good to Sophie over the years, too. So she's a really, nobody's got a bigger heart. But she's very you know, she's had to, since day one, make a brilliant career with less resources than anybody else and for more control than anybody else. It's not like she made a few films on a shoestring budget and then went to other producers. She's controlled everything forever, and she continues to. And that's why, like in 1967, she bought out everybody's share of La Pointe Courte, so she could control it and get all future profits and etc. It's not to be mean or something, but I think she's already in 1967 thinking, I'm going to control this into the future. But, you know, she wasn't thinking about DVD sales and video sales in 67 yet, but she, you know, she does manage to hold on to her stuff. And that's brilliant, I think. That's why we have good copies.
Right. Yeah. Yes, please.
I am very, very, very pleased to have seen this film today, because it seems to me it couldn't be more emblematic a film about Set. Set, I saw Set once for 30 years, and it's the Mediterranean at first, and second, you have there also the population. It's not for about that people are getting names, Latin name or Italian name, and the bel canto also. All of it is set too, and it means that a city living from the sea. I remember Set has to be the first fishing quay with relation to North Africa, for example, is the main a fishing port, you say. It's really great. This film, like a sociological geography.
Yeah, and it also separates her from a lot of what the later New Wave will do, which is about, you know, middle-class couples and sitting in cafes and that kind of stuff. It's just a completely different world. It's personal to her. She was there. But you're right, it's also a place that, and she likes to shine the light on things that don't always get covered, like the Gleaners.
If I might just jump in, I mean, you pointed out a few things that are already in this film that reappear later in his work, like the concern with gendered spaces, female, male workspaces. The piece of wood in the beginning reappears in L'Opéra Mouffe, for instance. And the notion of distributed authorship, which is already in the credits here, you know, this is a film by Agnès Varda, and the people of La Pointe Courte is something that runs through her entire work. She always tries to sort of attribute the work to everyone that's in the film. We had a long discussion about whether or not that works out with Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse. Whether that's sort of a liberal fiction, as Mark Siegel at the time, I think, was saying, or whether that actually works. But it's a concern. I mean, she gets, Bazin instantly identifies her as an auteur, gives her the seal of the highest seal of approval that he's capable of. But at the same time, she's sort of trying to deconstruct that.
And I think in the Glaneurs, you're right. I mean, she kind of, but she does, you know, meet some people and say, you're fascinating, can I come talk to you? And then she has other friends in it. Then they're filming some scene, and that one woman comes over and she says, oh, can I put you in my film? So it's still that notion of she knows exactly what she's doing and why, but then she takes these chance encounters and pulls them in. But she does, it is a community. I mean, she sees herself as a part of a community for every film she makes, whether it's Vagabond, finding a real homeless woman and interviewing her and taking her stories and putting them in the movie. I think in a lot of different films, she feels like she takes bits and pieces from lots of other people's stories and she kind of weaves them together into these kind of collages. So I think she sees herself certainly as putting many people's voices into the film.
Right. Kalani, please.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to what you just said about viewing these spaces that you don't often see. And I was thinking about, I really like this idea of like... looking at it kind of like as a game, or this game playing, or maybe like these intimate systems that you usually don't have access to, like the family in poverty in the first shot, or the illegal fishing going on, or the couple having a quarrel on the beach, and the way in which she films these different kinds of scenes, because they seem so different here. Like if I think of those three instances. The first scene is so different with the camera, and I love what she does there. It's a foreign object. You know that it's foreign. The presence of the person behind the camera is felt, and yet you still have, you know, the people acknowledging it, and yet with the system, kind of with the illegal fishermen, you know, you have a lot of like quick cuts, you have cuts behind a boat, you have cuts from the beach onto the boat. It's very disjunctive. And then with the lover's quarrel, you have like all this framing going on with the faces, and it's way more staged. So what is she doing with these like intimate spaces in this like initial film? And maybe we can talk then like about the ethics or the politics of that. How do you think she is working with these kind of environments to which one usually doesn't have access? And how does that show up in the cinematography?
It's a great question. I'm not sure there's a really master plan for this one in terms of space. And I think that's one of the things that makes it kind of fun and raggedy movie in certain ways. So it's not like, oh, the movie, the camera's going to come in wandering down these diverted alleys at the beginning, past things. It almost is like a series of, again, Ajay kind of photos of just empty spaces, because she doesn't come back out at that at the end. I think she does treat different people certainly differently, but that notion of and ethically how to approach the social problems versus the couple is fascinating. And I would just say there's the example of the cat, where the two women are like working, so gendered space, and then she's like, oh, these cats are everywhere. Well, that one's pregnant. Well, speaking of pregnant, what's her name, you know, is pregnant again. What, seven, you know, six, seven kids aren't enough? And then you suddenly cut to some lady coming out, and the camera comes in up to her doorway, shows like six little kids or seven little kids there hanging on the table and doing nothing, you know, and then sort of invades their space. And it's like not only a weird abstract way to get from, to introduce a woman who keeps having children and say she's kind of like a cat, but then also that the camera is again coming inside. And I think part of it really is somebody who's used to setting her camera at different angles is now figuring it can move, you know. Cameras are about time and space in movies. And I think a lot of it really is she's experimenting with tracking shots and handheld kind of stuff once in a while. But I think a lot of it does have to do with she really wants to see it as the outside, more theoretical world and theatrical world of the couple and the private spaces. And it kind of comes back still to that notion of secrets. This whole town's based on secrets. Well, we all openly fish where we're not supposed to. We, you know, so I think a lot of it ethically is she's fascinated with some of the open secrets in this area, who's having children, who isn't, and then some of the rules that seem to, you know, no, you can't date yet, although I married your mother when she was that age. So yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with gender, has to do with space, has to do internal, external, and a lot of it really is experimenting. I think she really is exploring. That's why I mean, I don't know where the heck the other 8.5 hours of footage are. I'm sure she's got them someplace. She keeps everything. But, I mean, again, she had 9 hours worth of stuff. So what would be really interesting is see what did she not include about spaces and things like that. But, yeah, the little boy in the drawer and that whole scene is just, you know, upsetting and theatrical at the same time. It's a very strange kind of scene, I think. So it's a good example of it. But you're right, there are three at least different kinds of uses of space. I don't know if that answers anything.
Okay, if there are no more questions.
Perhaps I would want to ask, do you think Agnes thinks that cats are the better humans? Because I would interpret this movie in this way.
It's like a whole other world going on. Like there's this whole other cat world. And then, because to end with now we're going to go drown some cats. I mean, it makes the whole movie about cats. So yeah, I think she does feel like there's this alternate almost universe of observers and people reacting and stuff. And it's almost like the couple doesn't notice the fishing community, and you know, the cats though are always there too, and sometimes they do refer to them. But you're right, yes, she and Renee both loved cats, but it is a strange kind of obsessive use of them in lots of different ways, yeah.
Sorry, just to stick with the cat theme, do you have any thoughts about her distinctions or interests in the differences between cats and lions? That does seem to run through her work as well.
The feline thing is constant. So yeah, yes, in terms of the whole notion of sort of the innocence of cats, but then yeah, the ultimate cats and stuff are real important. And then putting her cat up on top of the replace a lion and a monument and things like that. And the Zugu, when one of her favorite cats died, and she made this whole performance space for it, but had put it up to like a lion. So yeah, there's this real, I mean, I think she, there is that, this like a deep down fascination with cat communities. Yes. I don't know what it means, but she loves them. Cat videos. That's true. That's true.
Well, that's Maya Dern.
We've been very patient.
So then we say thank you very much for this incredible talk. Thank you, Richard
really
Neupert.
Honored to come. Thank you
for being here, and Vincent Zediger. And und das ist die beste Überleitung, die ich machen kann. Nächste Woche Lion's Love heißt der Film. Mark Siegel wird drüber reden. Ich wünsche Ihnen einen guten Nachhauseweg und kommen Sie dann wieder. Tschüss.